on Thursday nights at 6:30. That was a plug, y'all. Thursday nights at 6:30, I say this all the time. I say the greatest miracle you'll ever see is the one that you see when you look in the mirror.
Amen. That's right.
Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Here we go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you.
You know, this scripture was birthed, Brother Albert and I and Pastor Tony were sitting in his office talking. And from then, that this scripture was birthed into my spirit. You know, I know that you probably, when you looked at the title of it in the bulletin, it said, black and white or gray. Well, first I want to let you know I'm not talking about anything about race. And that the black and white area is the area of obedience. The gray area is the devil's area. And that's the area of disobedience. And you know, and while I thought about this, you know, as the Lord, that as we seek his help, he put his word into our spirit. You know, and it come clear to me out of John chapter 14. But before we get into the scripture, I just want to read just a page away out of Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, and also chapter 11, verse 1. You know, it's clear that how many of us believe that the God of the Old Testament is showing up the same God of the New Testament? Jesus Christ was then, he was back then, and he's right now. And what he says is binding today, and this is significant today as it was then. You know, in chapter 10 of Deuteronomy, verse 12, he says these words. He says, and now, O Israel, or in other words, in today's time, now, church. What does the Lord, your God, ask of you, or in some translation says, require of you? But to fear the Lord, your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord, your God, with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I am giving you today for your own good. Moses was speaking to Israel at that time, but you know, everyone that stands in before God and gives you the word today, he is giving you the same thing for your own good. And in 11:1, it says this: love the Lord your God and keep his requirements, his decrees, his laws and commands always. 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 Not sometime. Always. I just wanted to pave the way for our scripture reading today. Because it's a time now that as we look at this, you know, Jesus in John chapter 14, he's talking with the disciples before he's going to the cross. And he's building their confidence and their faith. But he's also pointing the way. He's giving them instructions on how to live once he's gone. You know, I just recalled in John chapter 13, verse 34, Jesus said, a new command I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. And that's going to be two topics today. That the most important is to love the Lord and to love one another. And as I was looking into this, I saw the first two commands of the Ten Commandments. To love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. And as Jesus even said in the Gospels, and to love your neighbor as yourself. So in John chapter 14, you know, Jesus is going to give what we all call a litmus test. It's a test of your love and obedience to him. You know, we all have a tendency that we, when time things come, that we act We react instead of responding. But I tell you what, let's just get into the word. Let's turn to John chapter 14, and let's all stand for the reading of the word. Because it's the day is a test of your love for the Lord. It's not about religion, it's not about ritual, it's about relationship. You know, the Bible says that he or she who's been forgiven much, love much. And he or she who's been forgiven less, loves less. I would inquire and ask everyone to be standing, please. If you're able, body today, that everyone be standing before the Lord today. We have to recognize who we are standing before. In this house and in this place, God's Spirit is in this place. And we're going to be reading the scriptures from John chapter 14, starting with verse 15, verses 21, verses 23 and 24. And it says this, I'm going to jump from all of them so you can understand. It said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. And in verse 21, it says, whoever has my commands and obey them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I too will love him and show myself to him. And in verse 23, it says, if anyone loves me, he will. He will. Everybody say that.
He will
obey my teaching. He will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me will not, say that, will not obey me. Obey my teachings. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. We can have a seat. Clearness of Jesus' teaching, that we have no, there's no problem about knowing where we are. You know, I love John chapter 14 because first thing Jesus does as he was talking to the disciples, when he said he was building their confidence. You know, the world always says, I believe God. But Jesus draws a point in John chapter 14, 1. He said, okay, you believe in God? Believe also in me. You know, the world has a problem when it comes to Jesus. So when we say God, who are we talking about? Do you see? When you talk about God, when you say God, who are you talking about? That name, Jesus, God has established his name forever. So he says, you believe in God, believe also in me. That's going to set the demise of many people today. Because when it comes to Jesus being God, they have a problem with it. But I know that I'm thankful that he's God, because that was God hanging upon the cross. And that's the only one that can save. Jesus told him, say, I will lay my life down, and I will take it up again. Who can only make that declaration? That's why I love John chapter 14, because he also make a promise to them that where he's going, he gives you a directive of heaven. And what all is prepared, he was giving them all of what's prepared for them, what he's going to prepare for. But he also gave them a promise that I will come back and get you. Let me ask you something. You know, Jesus loved us so much that he died in our place. I want to repeat that again because I want you to understand the depth of this. God loved you so much that he died the death you deserve. Now, if he died the death that you deserve, and you turn and you cast a high hand at him, and the offer of salvation, I'm going to talk to those that never received that finished work of Jesus Christ on their behalf. And you cast out your hand to go live in your sin, and you die in that condition, God also has a promise of the place that you will go. But Jesus is giving you a promise that he goes to prepare a place for you, because he's telling the disciples now that he's going to the cross, and he's preparing for it. You know, I love it, like I said, because of John chapter 14. I love John because as it begins, Jesus, the Lord Jesus builds our confidence. Though at the time he was talking to his disciples, but he's talking to everyone that opens his Bible. I always remember when anyone opened this Bible, he's talking to you. But always remember that, like I said, anyone that opens the Bible is talking to you. And embark upon his pages. And not only that, he's talking to the gathering too. Not just the individual, the gathering of the congregation. So everything that's being said from the Word of God is binding us to everyone that has an ear to hear today. You know, and that's to everyone who might have doubt. When I said about Jesus being God, if you have doubt, Jesus also builds the faith even with doubting Thomas. He builds his faith in John chapter 14. Because Thomas was doubting, they didn't know the way. People saying the way is a many ways. But Jesus clarifies it. That's why I say in John chapter 14, I love it, because he's building the disciples' confidence. And he's patient with them, even in their doubt. And when they say, show us the way, Jesus says this, I am the way. I am the only way. I am the only truth. And I am the only life. So if you're hearing anything else as you walk a long life's way about there's another way, God has only provided one way, and salvation only comes through Jesus Christ. So I love that as he starts to build that confidence, and then he comes down, then he comes to the very part of building the factor about their love. After he shared all this, then he's the love because of all that he's going to do for them. He said, if you love me, you will obey my command. And I want us to hold that note about commands, because we notice that as we read a few other verses, it says, obey my teachings. But it says, obey my commands. And as we go further into the scriptures, we'll understand what that command is. But first, I'll just give you one. I gave it to you out of John chapter 13, verse 34. Jesus said, a new command I give you. Anybody know that new command? Love. Everybody said, what is it? Love one another. Just as I have loved you. Just as I have loved you. He's building community, he's building the body of Christ right there with the disciples to love one another. That's sacrificial. See? So I love the way in the teaching of John chapter 14 and into 15, because it goes on, and even Jesus is steady going on as he's heading on towards his crucifixion. He's building the disciples up. Not only that, today he's telling you the same thing, that if you love me, you will obey me. It's not because you feel like it. Let me share with you. God don't deal with you because you feel like obeying it or you don't feel like it. God commands you to do it. And if you do it when the fire is hot, if you obey God when the fire is hot, guess what? God will take care of the rest. Yes, He'll take care of you. That's why I'm just thinking for how he draws things and how it's placed there for a reason. Because he already made the promise he's going to go, he's going, but he's going to come back. He's going. And that should be enough right there. If anyone ponder that very thing of eternity, if your life, if you're just looking at this life and you think that, well, I can continue to live like I want to live, I'm a Christian and I'm going to live like I want to live. No, God's standards is much higher than that, y'all. Much higher than what you ever would think. You know, as I started out with Deuteronomy chapter 10, I wanted to draw that because that's from the Old Testament. What does the Lord command you today? Or what does he require of you today? See, that you love the Lord. Keep. Also in the book of Deuteronomy, it tells you to bind it around your wrist. Write it on your doorpost. Wear it around your neck. Teach it to your children along the way. Speak it to yourself along the way. It has to be from the heart. If Jesus, if you know, if you've been saved, and God, you know your sins are forgiven, that God has forgiven your sins, it shouldn't be no problem with you to obey God and to love the Lord, because he loved you and he gave his all for you. There's going to be some tests here today. I said there's going to be a litmus test today on where you are. Because as you sit in this house and you say that you're a Christian and you're living your life in a mucky way, and you say that I'm a Christian, but you're not living accordingly. Jesus said, if you love me, everybody say that. If you love me, you will obey me. And say this with me. If you don't love me, you won't obey me. Ain't that plain? That is just plain right there. That's plain. You know, we can all examine our hearts and know. We know where we are. But the Word of God is living and is active and is powerful. And Jesus said, the words that I've said to you, these words are the words that are going to judge you in the last days. Remember that everything that's said in these words and through this Bible is binding. You know, I just want to also, we're going to turn over to John chapter 15. Now, we said we love the Lord. He said, you love me. If you love me, you obey my teaching. Now, in John chapter 15, verses 10 through 14, he says this. If you obey my command, you will remain in my love, just as I obeyed my Father's command and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. How many of you today, it seems that there's something going wrong with you in your mind? You just can't seem to get it or figure it out. You seem that there's just, you know, I think it's like this, that I see an angry Christian and I say, well, what is a Christian doing walking around angry? What are you walking around angry? He says this, if you obey my commands. See, we have a tendency that we, as me and my brother Alvin was talking, and I thank God for my brother Alvin this morning, I first said, respond. He said, no, react. Because it's true. The way we react, if we react in impulse at every little thing somebody say, that's the test. I want you to start paying attention to the tests in your life. When somebody come and rub you the wrong way, Jesus said, if you love me, you're going to obey me. Jesus said, they rubbed me the wrong way, and I didn't even open my mouth. And Jesus says this, that a servant is not greater than his master. So, as they did it to the master, they do it to the servant. So, but Jesus says this, be of good cheer. Can you do that? See, and there's very teachings about this. This is a test in you to find out where you're at. See? It's to find out. You know, I get a lot of things that come about me. I work for the Union Rescue Mission. And there's a lot of things that come to me every single day.
Yeah.
If it ain't the bosses, it's something else. But it tells me to do my work unto the Lord, not to men. Now, do I apply that to my life? I try as best as I can to do everything that I do unto the Lord. There, do I fail at it at times? But you know what I do? Get up. Knock the dust off me. I learn from it. And turn back. I don't continue with a bad attitude. With a bad attitude and a memory of playing stuff in my mind. No, I look at my life. And I look at my reactions to it. And I feel bad about it when I react the wrong way. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey me. Because the Holy Spirit brings it to memory about when you do. Now, why do you act like that, Gary? And I feel bad about it. And I confess it to the Lord. And I choose not to live like that again. So the thing is that in chapter 15, it said, if you obey my command, you will remain in my love. Just as I have obeyed my Father's command. How come Jesus can obey? See, because that's the key. He obeyed to the fullest for us, so that should give us all the initiative through love to obey him. God says, this is my son, in whom I'm pleased. Hear him. He said, hear him. See? So, he says, just as I have obeyed my Father's command and remain in his love, I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this. Hear this, O Israel. Remember, we read this in Deuteronomy. Hear, O Israel. Or hear, O church. My command is this. That you love each other as I have loved you. As I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than he laid down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. Ain't that plain? You know, as scriptures confirming scripture, you know, as a scripture that goes with this, y'all, you know, in researching scripture and with the help of the Spirit, you know, it's just plain the Bible. It's amazing sometimes when you find that everything ties together. It ties together. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. And watch how this ties together with John chapter 15. That scripture, I'm going to read starting at verse 1 of chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians because I like that word instruction that it says. I don't know if your Bible says instructions, but mine does. It says this. Finally, brother, we instruct you to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of our Lord Jesus. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control his own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the heathens, who do not know God, and that in this matter no one should wrong his brother or take advantage of him. The Lord will punish men for such sins, as we have already told you and warned you. For God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. Therefore, he who rejects this instruction does not reject man, but God who gives the Holy Spirit. Amen. What I share with you, I meant to share with you when I first start come up. And I say, don't look at me. I was going to say, don't look at me, just hear the message. Because I'm nobody. But you hear the message today. Instructions. Instructions. So no one have a problem with anything when you continue on living in a habitually way to say I'm a Christian and say that you love the Lord. He's given instructions here that you be sanctified, that may be set apart, different from the world. Now, as we were talking about Jesus in John chapter 15, he said, now, a new commandment, or I give you, this is my command. Now listen at this. He said that you love one another. Watch you hear it again here. In verse 9, it says, now about brotherly love. We do not need to write you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all the brothers throughout Macedonia. And we urge you, brothers, to do so more and more. How many of you have a problem with your Christian brothers and sisters? If you got a problem with your Christian brothers and sisters, guess who you got a problem with? Because are you better than they?
No.
Are you more perfect than they?
No.
So what are you angry with them for? If grace have brought you, then that grace brought them. And it's because of that grace, which come from who? It didn't come from me. So God's word says that his children stands and falls to him. And so do you. That's why, because of that grace, we can easily love one another. Easily love one another. You know, scripture ties in so well, it just sometimes, it gets me. I'm going to be honest with y'all. You know, when it comes time for me, the pastor asked me to step in for me. I get scared. I get some emotions, I guess. I get scared. My knees get tonight. I don't know. But it's a good place to be when you don't know. Because when you don't know, the Lord takes over. Because you got to know one thing. It's not about you. It's all the power that comes from him. It's not no power within me that I can glory in anything that I stand up here to say. Because I'm a nobody. But I do one thing, and I have a willingness that if I look like a fool before you, I'm a fool for Christ Jesus. If I stutter in my words or get caught up, it's all for the sake of the Lord. See? So these things come about that as I ponder in my mind, you know, I look at my failures, y'all, I do. But you know, when I look at my failures and I see, man, why do I keep on, I mess up? Then I go to Romans chapter 14 when Paul talked about himself. And it plays in my mind and says, oh, I should want to do good. But then Paul comes out in exuberant praise at the end. Praise, but thanks be to God for Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Because it's not about my perfection. Jesus is the perfect sacrifice for me on my behalf. Amen. And he helped me in a process. And that love for God, who God loves, then I love. Because the Bible tells me that God loves his children. And now to tie in with that, turn with me to 1 John chapter 3. Remember, Jesus said, everybody say command, this command. Love. Okay. Now turn with me to John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, yeah. Thank you, brother. And we're going to read 14 through 16. Now here's a, what I said about the litmus test, here's a note that God says that you can know that you have passed from death to life. But it's a tall tale sign with it. And if this sign is not a sign that's following you, is what the Bible is saying, if it's not following you, because it says, in some translations it says, by this, you know. And it says now that we call this all together, it says, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love our brother. And don't forget the sister. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life in it. Amen. This is how we know. Now here's the key that I gave to you from the gate when Jesus was preparing in John chapter 14. This is how we know what love is. Jesus laid down his life for us. Isaiah said that I dwell among people with unclean lips. See, Ezekiel, all of them. And when you're in the presence of God, you get a very thing. When you're in his presence, this word would be the presence of God because this is the very word of God. And when it speaks to you, God is speaking to you about you.
Hallelujah.
But he's also lavishing his love upon you.
Right.
Through his patience. So we see the black and the white. Obedience. I obey the Lord because I love the Lord. We don't do it too well. But we get up. Those of us that do, we fail, we get up. Though a righteous man or woman fall 7 times, he's going to get up and the Lord's going to help you. And anybody that's sick to say, according to 1 John, and this is to the believer, it says this. In John, 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. He or she that says they without sin have made him to be a liar. And that's talking to the believer. That's talking to the believer. Because we all sin. I love when I look in 1 King, when I look at King Solomon when we pray, and he says, Lord, we all have sinned, but there's no one that does not sin. We don't habitually practice sin. Don't we get as children of God, we don't habitually practice the sin, but there's sins in the thought. There's the sin of omission and commission. We fail in many ways. We let the flesh get in the way sometimes, and it causes. But the Holy Spirit brings to mind, man, you should have did that. That's not good. And then you take 1 John 1, 9, you take it on. It says, confess it. God is faithful. He's just. He loves you. He's going to forgive you and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Don't you just love somebody like that? What a great God we have, y'all. That you know, though we're imperfect and we fail, and we done did before we come to Christ, look at all that we done did. But he called us by his grace through his son. How can we not love him and then love one another? Messed up folks like us. But we all headed to heaven. We're going to live together for eternity, y'all. How come we can't together, we can't show a little heaven right here on earth together? Little heaven right here on earth together. So we know the pastor Doe right there can see and say, wait a minute, they see all these people, man, look at all these people loving each other. And that's what's wrong out there. Love is missing, it's lacking. And people are searching for it. And when the church is in disharmony, people pass, look at that crazy church. How in the world am I going to go in there? Stay out here. So, but Jesus said, they'll know you are my disciples by your love. So that black and white area. Now watch this. I'm going to get my brother Albert to tell you. What's that gray area, Albert? The devil's area. You know, I want to watch this in my heart. You know, as we read in 1 Thessalonians, it said the sexual immorality part. I want to be obedient to the Spirit. You know, those of us that's living in unmarried areas of our life. and we say we're Christians and we're living outside of God's plan for marriage. I want you to know God wants you to sever it. He wants you to sever it. I don't care how you feel about it, what you think about it. God said, let the marriage bed be honorable. And he says, not before his face, and say that you're a Christian. Don't live with it, don't touch it. But you know, as you go back to show you how many of us is messed up that same way. Before Christ, and maybe even after Christ. But God in that spirit straightens out. But don't continually, that you hear the word of God and you live in that. And don't separate that yourself from it. And then make plans to get married. You know, I thank God for first of myself and my wife that in this house with the example to set in marriage. And then along come the way my brother Joe and Sister Harry. As, no, this is serious. As an example that you marry, it's better to marry than to burn with passion, y'all. It's better to marry. And because remember, we said that as the grace has come upon us all in the church, there's no imperfect people. There's no perfect people. Their husband and wife, and they're not perfect either. But you know, God is amazing that even through your imperfections, he commands you to grow together. Two imperfect people. And you let love be the common ground. We just, see? So I'm not saying this to condemn because I don't have the power to condemn, but I do say it to encourage and to say that you need to get it right. And now it's binding, guess what? Because you inherit it from the Word of God. So in saying this, now comes the most important part in our life. And I'm gonna call my sister up, Sister Geraldine, because I have confidence in her. I love my Sister Geraldine and faith in her evangelistic